Hello, and welcome to a special episode, Survivance, with the Pisces Life Podcast. I am one of your hosts. I am just Letitia, and on the other microphone, my other sis.
It is I, Kai Love.
We have a very special treat for you tonight. First of all, we are excited. You know that we have been doing our Survivance project. It's not too late for you to get in on you submitting your story. Mm-hmm. We have been doing our storytelling and media project about life 1 year in the pandemic, what it's been like for you. We've been doing call outs and all of that to get your stories about your experiences. Your voice matters. It's important. And tonight we are here with one of our very special guests. I love the title that you're given, Renegade, Ada Cheng from Chicago. Dr. Ada Cheng's approach to storytelling centers on two goals, the liberation and self-permission to tell our own stories and to create community-building spaces that provide safe haven for those stories to be told. Ada reframes our vulnerability as not our enemy, but as our friend. And that's a quote from Randy Kim, who's the host and creator of the Bon Me Chronicles podcast. I thought that was such a beautiful introduction. So let us welcome Ada Cheng.
Oh, thank you so much. I'm so honored to be here. Kai Love, Letitia. So nice to be here after like more than a year.
The timing is right. Everything is in perfect divine alignment for us to have this experience tonight.
Absolutely.
So I want to jump right in. One of the things that we wanted to talk to you about is being a storyteller, being someone who is the gatherer of communities of survivors. Absolutely. And coming from the Asian community and being a part and a leader in the Chicago area, what are some of the stories that have held you nearest and dearest during this time of the pandemic?
Absolutely. You know, stories related to anti-Asian racism, story about diaspora experiences, stories about sexual assault, intimate partner violence, child abuse. Stories are oftentimes about racism, trauma, and violence. And I'll say a few words why I started producing shows for stories that really difficult, what I call the difficult and vulnerable stories. I remember I started telling stories and I started doing open mic in January 2016. Mm-hmm. And started doing shows, let's say, in April, May, right? And so I went on and do shows. And this is something very interesting. A couple of things I observed in the Chicago storytelling scene at the time. Number one, I would be one of the few Asian, or let's say BIPOC storytellers in the scene, right? One of the few. So I would be one of the few Asian American storytellers. That's one. Number two, what I observed, who is the audience? Predominantly middle-class white audience.
Wow.
And what I, at the time, right, in 2016, and what also distinguished myself from others, and this is not out of a choice. I mean, I tell stories because I have to share them. And I noticed something very distinct. What were the stories I was telling at the time? In the beginning, sure, I was telling funny stories. But in 2016, think about late 2015, 2016, what happened? Donald Trump came out for presidency. And I felt a sense of responsibility that is, if I'm out telling stories, I need to tell stories that are important, that are socially relevant, that respond to social concerns of our time. And so what was the story I was telling? Stories about immigration, myself being an immigrant, the prejudice and bias toward immigrants, racism, And so I was telling stories about critiquing structural inequities, stories. And after 2016, I was telling those stories. In 2017, I started telling far more, you know, intimate, difficult stories about sexual assault and intimate partner violence. And then I realized that when I was at shows produced by white producers, they say if there are six tellers, the rest of the tellers will be telling funny stories, entertaining the audience. And I will be the odd one out telling stories about structural inequities, racism, and gender-based violence. And so it felt, number one, lonely. Number two, it was not the right platform for me. I realized I was there. It was as if I was became the token. Whether that was their intention. I mean, and of course I was there as a token in the sense that oftentimes I would be the only Asian.
Sure.
Right. Or the only teller from the BIPOC communities. Right. Mm-hmm. And so that token, but also the stories that I was telling became a situation where it was, it becomes a situation where if you are not careful, when we tell stories, we're always working against existing stereotypes and assumptions.
Yes.
Right? So yes. If you're not, so when I was standing in front of a predominantly white, middle-class white audience, right? Middle-class mm-hmm. white audience, I was worried at some point, as much as these stories were true to me, real to me, honest, I was being honest, I would be concerned to say if I told stories about intimate partner violence, how was it going to reinforce mm-hmm. the stereotypes of Asian women being submissive, docile, right? And if the partner is Asian man, how is it going to reinforce the stereotypes about Asian men as the domineering? Mm-hmm. And so it becomes the question of number one, how is this show produced? It's really about entertaining and really appeal to a particular middle-class, upper-class white audience, their taste, particular the sort of trauma stories from marginalized communities, right? And whether I'm telling that and how that particular audience is going to receive it, that made me very concerned. And I realized, okay, this is not the right context. And is it possible for me to produce shows that really center stories about enable people to tell difficult and vulnerable stories? The audience, however, will be from our own community members, as opposed to a middle upper class white audience. Is it possible that I can producing a way that de-emphasize entertainment, right? But emphasize vulnerability and honesty, right?
Wow.
So these were really the epistemological issues that I was struggling with, mm-hmm. right? How do I create shows that even when I invite tellers, if they it's a brave space for them, even though it may not be safe, it may not be comfortable for them, mm-hmm. that after they tell their stories, they know the whole event is not for entertainment. And after they tell their stories, they will feel respected, right? They will feel that their stories are well received. And so these are the things that I really struggle with, you know, when I started out producing shows. And so I went from being a storyteller, just telling stories, to really having a sense of responsibility as a mm-hmm. producer that I need to create platforms for people to tell stories that we normally don't hear in the scene. That I took my paid my responsibility very seriously, that I go out of my way to excavate stories, invite people that we don't see in the scene. And I also sort of play around this whole idea of, you know, not all stories tellers have good stories to tell, but sometimes people with important stories to tell may not be skilled storytellers yet.
Ooh, that's a good
and
point.
So, does it make sense?
Mm-hmm.
And so otherwise, if I say this is an artist space and I'm going to only have skilled storytellers, you're only going to see the same people over and over again. And I don't want that. I really want to, my goal is to, you know, if I think about this, it's oral history. I really view this as an oral history.
Oh, yes.
Just like what you're doing, right?
Mm-hmm.
That your goal is about excavate stories that marginalized, invisibilized, but they need to be heard. And so I want to invite those stories into my space and create a brave space for people to tell their stories.
That is absolutely beautiful. Absolutely beautiful. The way that you've laid it out, from the vulnerability to do it to also the responsibility to do it. Beautiful. Sis, you had a question?
Yeah, I love the intentionality behind the space. And I love, Ada, that you have done the work of self-assessment, because I think sometimes as storytellers, we feel like there is a story to tell. So we want to try to curate and craft the atmosphere to reflect the story that we believe is the story that needs to be told, instead of providing safe spaces for people to share their vulnerable selves. And I have participated in several of your storytelling series. I want you to share with our audience your storytelling shows. I know that you do Am I Man Enough? You do the Speaking Truth series, The Poor One Out, Talk Stories, and This is America. Talk to our audience a little bit about those storytelling shows and the differences between those shows.
So the first one that I produce and host is Poor One Out, which you have been to. And that show is actually tied to the Volumes Book Cafe. It originated, it was a show that was created by the bookstore. And so I took over producing and hosting it. And so it is a general theme show, you know, the very general storytelling show. Each month, I simply create a theme, and I invite, you know, people from different identities and backgrounds to share their stories. And they can be people who work in nonprofit organizations, educators, poets, storytellers, writers, everybody, community members. The second show that I created is called Am I Man Enough? It was said in late 2017. And you know, 2017, Me Too movement, right? And so there was really an urgency for us to talk about, I didn't want to just emphasize the gender-based violence, right? We know what's the consequences, what's the result. What I was interested is whether as individuals and as a collectivity, can we look at the root of it, which is toxic masculinity, one of the major roots. If you look at, right, all our social problems, whether it is racism, white supremacy, gun violence, domestic violence, sexual assault, right, political extremism, underlying the core is the toxic masculinity, the violence of male supremacy. And so for me, it is very important, right, to create a show for everyone to examine their experiences. All of us have interaction, right, with toxic masculinity. And so I want people to tell stories. And it is through that particular shows that I started, even though I knew what was coming, but it was increasingly clear to me that became a show where people realized that it was a space that they could tell stories about sexual assault, right? Intimate partner violence, that it was okay, it was not odd.
Mm-hmm.
And so when I started seeing that, I became very intentional. I was specific to tell people, this is really the show where you don't need to feel the need. I say that to all the shows, but everyone, but this is a show I would say you don't need to feel the need to entertain the audience. This is a show where you can tell difficult and vulnerable things that you might feel ashamed. You might feel it's a stigma. You might feel embarrassed. You might not, you know, whatever it is, if you feel brave enough to share, this is it. And I had to make sure, and part of it is increasingly, I had to pay attention to also how I host the show, which means that, you know, as a host, and you know this as a producer and a host, you can't simply just stay quiet, sit there, quote, tell difficult and vulnerable stories, right?
Yes.
Something got to be done. So I really need to learn how to make sure that it is an environment where people feel safe, where people feel respected. They don't feel that it simply toss out their stories and then it goes nowhere, right? And so I have to be very intentional creating that space. The other show that I created is Talk Stories, Asian American, Asian Diaspora Storytelling Show. And this is a show that I created in early 2018 specifically for members of the Asian American community and Asian diaspora community. Mainly because at the time when I look at the scene, there weren't any spaces for community members from the Asian community to really tell stories. And here's the thing is, number one, usually you see a few artists, Asian American artists, kind of telling stories, and not everyone feels comfortable or wants to, I would say, you know, tell stories at a space where that the audience are, you know, predominantly white audience. They may not feel comfortable doing that. They may not want to do that. And I really want a space where I can take these shows to community spaces, right? And I want the tellers to be community members. This is a show that I very much work very hard to make sure that I integrate community members, meaning people who have no performance backgrounds, that I want them to be the tellers. I also make sure they are not just community leaders, because we know leaders don't reflect the overall opinions and thoughts of the community. They are the privileged, right?
Well, right.
So I make sure that I go deep and I bring those shows to community centers, and I bring everybody, the audience, to the community centers. Part of it is for us to know each other's history, because we sometimes don't know each other's stories, right? I want people to get a sense of what each community center is doing and what's the history. So I have worked with National Cambodian Heritage Museum, Chinese American Museum of Chicago, and also Japanese American Service Committee. And so I bring people to these spaces, we learn about their history, and then we use the storytelling events as a community gallery. You have community members who are not performers and publicly, you know, share their stories in front of their own people, their friends. And that for me, and I'll tell you, I have gotten so many, you know, a lot of community members, the reason that they're willing to share is because they see their friends tell stories.
Yes.
And so I have gotten a lot of tellers from that they witness their friends doing that, so they feel more comfortable. I have also, I also produce Speaking Truth series, really allows me to come up with things that can respond to social concerns about time that I can do with Pour One Out. The most recent one is This is America, Truth Through My Body. And I'll tell you how did I come up with this concept. You know, it really stems from the police brutality, George Floyd murder, you know, the murder of trans women, particularly black and brown trans women, the police brutality, the police suppression, oppression of protesters. And all these for me is to think about, we tell stories, we think we're telling stories from the head. And what I want to do is to create a show for us to talk about our bodily experiences. For example, when we think about racism, when we think about discrimination, it's not just about perception, about what's in the head. is our daily lived experiences. It affects us, our bodily experiences, bodily embodied experiences. And so this show is really for us to critically examine how our bodily experiences will be different because of the structural context. And so these are the shows that I have been producing.
We are so just excited that you are here and echo just everything that you've said. And again,
yes.
I can't stress how important it has been in your storytelling journey, as well as in your curation of storytelling moments.
Yes.
We can see the evolution. And it's mm-hmm. not that you weren't involved in fighting anti-racism or fighting partner violence previously. It's, I believe, in a lot of ways, being so intentional and thoughtful about who you invite to the stage and how that makes such a difference. And we strive, even in this project, Survivance, certainly we've interviewed a couple of community champions and people that one may deem as having status or at least being well known in certain circles. But we really wanted to hear from what we're calling, and we don't mean this to be disrespectful, but everyday people doing and activating their lived experiences and how powerful us as people in our gathering spaces, and even sometimes in those curated spaces, how much power can come from the sharing and telling of stories.
Absolutely. And I would say, you know, to do that, it really takes effort in the sense that you're oftentimes dealing with community members who feel shy. They might not know what storytelling is, even though the truth is they have been mm-hmm. doing that in their daily life, right? And part of the process is to demystify for them what storytelling is. And there's a lot of prep to do in terms of writing, and also to get them to the point where they feel ready, right? They oftentimes, it's one thing to say, I'm ready. It's another thing to get on stage in front of an audience. We're artists, so it's public speakers. It's not daunting to us. But it really took me a while to realize
yes.
it's daunting for some of them that this really is their first time to share stories. So the work that I have to go into, but fundamentally, at the end of the day, right, it's still an event. And so I have to really, you know, assume uncertainty and the risk, right? And so a lot of the work needs to be done, right, to just prep them to the point to feel comfortable to share. And here's the thing that I have, and I'm glad that I have insisted on this principle. You know, people like to use the word amplify and uplift. And I see people amplify and uplift. And here's my thing. If you always amplify people who already have a platform, who are known, who are famous, who are visible, that's not amplifying, because they're already amplified. And if the people that you uplift are already more successful, more visible, and more known, already sort of visible members in their community, that's not uplift. When we say uplift, that means from where we are, we uplift people. Right? Utilize our privilege. Mm-hmm. And so for me, it's easy. It's easy for me to just get artists and performers, but I avoid doing that because I realize they already have a platform. They don't need another platform, but there are people in the community. For them, this will be the only time that they tell stories. And so I take that very seriously. As much as it takes a lot of work, I am, you know, committed to that. So that's something that I'm proud of. And the other thing that is important for me, and I think you know this, is, you know, we talk a lot about cross-racial solidarity, right? And the truth is that so important for me to put people from different racial backgrounds together. So in a storytelling show with the same thing, right, the same concept, it is a great way to simply compare mm-hmm. and contrast our experiences. So for each show, when I have people from different backgrounds, when they tell stories, that people can tell, the audience know that all of us are shaped by racism, but we're shaped by racism in very different ways.
Mm-hmm.
And so through storytelling, you also present a very comparative perspective of who we are as racial subjects, right, in this country. So mm-hmm. so it allows me, when I integrate people from different communities, it allows me to do many different things.
That is well said and beautiful in action as well. I love the fact that you made the distinction of amplifying voices and the privilege that's within that. When you host a platform, when you have a standing within a community, your own and the greater community especially, it seems like this duality that's expected, you know, beholden to the crowd that does this, you know, they are performers. They are those who have an audience, a following already, versus those who, like you said, may never speak another word other than this one moment, this one time. Can you speak to what is that is transformed? Because as you were talking, I was thinking about how this is actually a call for community. Not only do you realize that you're not alone in your experiences, one of the pieces of your story that I find relevant, especially right now, not only are we hashtag stop Asian hate, but we're also hashtag give women a break. My goodness. I'm talking about specifically the incident at North Carolina. Kai, help me out. What is her name?
Yeah, from the 1619 Project.
Yes, from the 1619 Project. That's what I was getting at. But in this spot of This Is America, nothing has been more glaring than This Is America, than the previous administration and all of those things that glaringly and dangerously brought to light. You know, I knew that there were some things, you know, that happened in government, of course, but boy, oh boy, I've never seen things the way that they are. So let's talk about voice and agency, even in the midst of a pandemic, because This Is America started during the pandemic. Storytelling is more relevant now more than ever. Agree? Disagree?
Absolutely. It's interesting where, and I'm not going to, you know, I can't speak for everybody, but, you know, it's when I was growing up, this expression, we don't need to talk about artistic expression, just this sort of public speaking expression is not encouraged in my culture. And I, you know, I have heard that from, you know, other community members in terms of it, because there's such an emphasis on, you just, you know, do the exam, you know, you just take the test. But this idea of speaking to communicate, mm-hmm. of expressing your feelings, vulnerability in public, it's not something that, you know, commonly encouraged in the Asian culture. Mm-hmm. And so in the beginning, you know, when I was telling stories, it's very intriguing for people. And people would say to me, oh, you can do that? You know, how do you tell stories in public? And particularly, I'm going to say, I have been told, you know, you can tell I have an accent, right? It's not strong, but you can tell that I am not somebody who grew up in this country. And I have been told that it is so important for them to see somebody who doesn't speak perfect English,
oh,
right?
Yes.
Not a native speaker, mm-hmm. to be able to tell stories and host shows without any kind of anxiety about that I have to, that I don't have to say, like, it has to be perfect. I mean, the point is about communication. If I can communicate, that's all that matters. And so for me, you know, it's really interesting for people to see me out there. And I know the truth is everyone has stories to tell, right? And what they need is, what people need is, they see somebody doing it and they started to wonder, well, maybe I can do that too. And so for me, is this, you know, how do I get them to the point where they feel comfortable, because a lot of time they have to overcome shame, embarrassment, stigma, judgment, right? That's not easy, the psychological part. And there's another part about public speaking, telling that truth, publicly announce it in public for other people to know, that's also difficult. And then to tell a story to say, you don't need to worry. You don't need to be an artist to do this, because you have been telling stories every day.
All the
you
time.
You can trust your, you right? Every day, all mm-hmm. the time. Call our friends, what's going on today? What happened today? That's storytelling.
Yes.
And to get them to that point to say, and then to convince them, this is a, I have been asked over and over, I don't know if people would be interested in my stories.
Mm-hmm.
And I will say to them, number one, who cares?
If they're not, that's right.
Who cares? And number two, everyone's stories are important.
Yes.
Community leaders, my stories, your story, everyone's stories are important. Number three is this, and I sometimes have to tell people, it's just like in life, I can convince you that your stories are important.
Mm-hmm.
If you cannot convince yourself, part of it is that you have to convince yourself. And for community members, that's really a challenge to come forward and say, I believe my stories are important. They deserve a platform. They deserve space. They deserve to be heard. That's a level of confidence and self-assertion and affirmation that we sometimes take for granted. And that's not everybody. And so to get them to that point, for them to believe that their stories are important, they need to be heard,
mm-hmm.
that's the tough part. And that's over and over again that people will ask me, and I have to do a lot of work. But
yes.
The thing is this, once they kind of cross that threshold, once they have done that one time,
mm-hmm.
once they are able to kind of stand in front and then just tell their stories the first time, then you can see the transformation. And I'll tell you one example. I collaborated with National Cambodian Heritage Museum on their Day of Remembrance. These are community members who, for the older generations, have experienced genocide, right? So they experienced genocide in Cambodia, escaped to refugees, and finally made it to the United States. And
mm-hmm.
this year, what we decided to do was to work with women who had never told their stories before.
Wow.
So early this year, when I worked with these three women, they never told their stories in public. And it was through months of working. And then finally, on the Day of Remembrance, during that ceremony,
mm-hmm.
they told their stories the first time. What was the transformation?
Wow.
The level of confidence
mm.
that they have about themselves, right? Number one, they now truly believe. When I tell them, you can go to university class, do public speaking, give personal testimonies, you can do that. They believe me now. You can also tell how much confidence they gain about themselves.
Yes.
And it is the most important thing over and over that we have to tell them, your stories are important.
Yes.
Stories need to be told, and people, particularly the younger generation, mm-hmm. want to hear them. And so that's what I have seen in terms of transformation. Give people a space
mm-hmm.
where they feel empowered, where they feel they have a voice, that they are important, they're affirmed, and that's very rewarding for me.
Absolutely beautiful. As part of this broadcast tonight, as part of our podcast and for the Survivance series, we wanted to make sure that we gave you the space to do, which is to tell a story. It's one that you've chosen to share. It's one that we are ready to hear. And it's one that I think for our audience members, there will be an awakening in them like it was in us. So we're going to turn the microphone over to you for closing comments from the interview and then to go into your sharing of your story.
It took me 10 years. In February 2020, I was invited by a faculty member from the Global Asian Studies program at UIC to do presentations for his Asian American courses. The presentation was entitled Sexual Assault on College Campus and Asian American Experiences. This presentation was different for me for at least two reasons. It was the first time that I presented for college classes with predominantly Asian American students. Staring at faces similar to mine hit me viscerally. It was also the first time that I did something very different with my materials. I started my talk with the following major topics: the American colonization in Asia, her military and political interventions in the Asian region, and the United States' racist and imperialist legacies in Asia. The constructed images of Asian women as docile, submissive, exotic, sensual, and sexually willing, and the sexual fetishization of Asian American women. The historical, symbolic, and cultural emasculation and desexualization of Asian American men. The necessity to center race in sexual assault discourse. Why is race and why are racialized images central to our understanding of sexual assault? If you're perceived to be submissive, docile, sensual, exotic, and fetishized, is it possible that your objections, even if they're firm, can be disregarded over and over? Is it possible that if you're perceived to be sexually willing and available, your rejections, even if they're clear and persistent, can be fantasized in a twisted way to mean affirmations? Immediately after the class, a student approached me and said, "Thank you for your presentation. I really appreciate the way you approach this topic. You made this material relevant to me and my experiences." I knew what she meant. She didn't mean that my presentation was relevant to her as a woman. She meant it was relevant to her as an Asian woman in this country. Her remark shook me to my core, not only in terms of how I should do training on gender-based violence in the future, but also how I had to re-examine my own sexual assault. I had to ask myself, why did I tell the story the way I did? Why did I leave out certain details? And most importantly, why was my identity as an Asian woman never given a proper place in my own public account of the story? My sexual assault took place in 2010. He was a colleague of mine in the department at a well-known university in Chicago. He was a friend, a progressive faculty, and a comrade. One who will march with women and speak up for us. Yet he sexually assaulted me despite my repeated rejections. I couldn't even name it as rape until another close colleague of mine named it for me. I could not reconcile his good man image in public with the violence he committed in private. I'm not sure if he was aware of the dissonance either. I've told this story in public a few times and published it in print since 2016. I left out something important. I decided not to discuss race in the story to mitigate the stereotyping that might ensue. My colleague is an immigrant of color, a member of a marginalized community. I left out that detail because of the larger political climate of our time. In 2015, when Donald Trump came out running for presidency, his campaign relied on demonizing immigrants, particularly immigrant men of color, constructing them as drug dealers, traffickers, criminals, and rapists. I didn't want this to become another statistic contributing to the portrayal of immigrant men of color as the villain in our larger cultural and political landscapes. since I didn't name his race. I didn't explore how my own race might have played a part in my own victimization. I have been troubled by my own omission, since my racial identity as an Asian woman has been central in my existence as an immigrant woman of color in this country and my experiences as an immigrant woman of color faculty in academia. In the way my colleagues have dismissed my presence, appropriated my intellectual labor, and discounted my contributions. In the way my students have disregarded my authority as a tenured faculty member. And in a way I have been told to go back to my country and consistently asked where I'm from originally, even after I became a citizen in 2015. How could race be so salient in all my experiences as an immigrant woman of color, yet so absent at this moment of intimate violation? What other pernicious effects can this erasure of race have? What I didn't say to students in 2020 is this. Is it possible that because of these images developed and constructed out of the American racist colonial imperialist legacies, you will be perceived as a complicitous collaborator in your own sexual assault, not only by others, but also by yourself? Is it possible that we also come to see ourselves as complicit in the violence against us? I did, questioning myself in terms of the legitimacy of the rape, because there was no brute force, because it was not in the dark alley, because he was no stranger but someone I trusted, because I didn't fight back and yell, because I thought I would salvage a friendship, and because I stayed quiet and let it go afterwards, pretending nothing had happened. Exactly the same way I dealt with anti-Asian racism early on in my life in this country. On March 16, a white man murdered 8 people in Atlanta, among them 6 Asian women. In a press conference, the sheriff minimized the violence against these Asian women by labeling it as the shooter's trouble with sexual addictions. Within 1 month of my arrival in this country in 1991, I learned a particular form of racial profiling unique to me as an Asian woman via this phrase, "I like Asian women." This phrase has been said to me millions of times throughout decades by men of all races, particularly white men. The key word here is Asian, not woman. Men are looking for a particular set of titillating images and stereotypes in me. I'm not important. The collective we that they have been fantasizing is what satisfies their sexual desire. I'm never just a woman. I have always been an Asian woman. In an effort to protect my perpetrator, I never once asked how my identity as an Asian woman, as well as the images based on the racist misogyny in his fantasies, might have played a role in his repeated refusals to accept my rejections. I obscured the fact that I had consistently experienced racialized misogyny and sexism from men of color. Even until this day, I still do not know how to address the harm done to one another within marginalized communities. I wrote myself, the inseparable Asian woman, out of my own narratives and blended myself within the abstract category of woman. When you write yourself out of your own stories, there's no story to tell about you or for you. It took me 10 years. Let it not be your 10.
I mean, I had to take a deep breath. Let it not be 10. Let it not be your 10. So much there. Thank you for sharing that story. Thank you for being with us tonight. This has been a special edition of the Pisces Life Podcast with Ada Cheng, renegade, storyteller, and powerhouse of voices being amplified. Those that you don't know, maybe have never heard of before, there is room for you. There is community for you. Again, this has been a special edition of the Pisces Life Podcast, Survivance, episode 170.
And it's a good one. Ada, if people are looking for you on the internet, on the interwebs, on your socials, how can people connect with you? How can people hear about your shows? How can people participate in your shows?
Very good. The best way to follow for events will be on Facebook. Number one, they can follow Renegade Ada Cheng. It's Dr. Ada Cheng that's on my Facebook. And they can also follow me on Instagram, SJADACHENG. That's another one. Or they can follow me through website, www.renegadeadacheng. So that's another way to follow me.
We will include all of that information within our show notes. And sis, you know, if they're looking for me, they can find me in the streets, still locked because of trolls. I'm not ready to come off and behind this lock just yet. Every time I think I'm ready, somebody gets the timeline to cackling and going on. And I don't want to deal with trolls. And, you know, there are political things that are happening that I'm interested in. This is America, and I'm going to talk about it. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So if anybody is looking for me, I am just Letitia everywhere. L-E-T as in Tom, I-T-I-A. And sis, if they are looking for you, where can they find you?
They can find me being very excited because I will be appearing on Pour One Out later this year. So thinking about what I'm going to tell. I'll be in preparation because it's not about entertainment, but it's about being vulnerable and figuring out what is the story I want to put out with this theme. And thanking again, Ada, for joining us today. They can find me on the interwebs. I am on Facebook and Twitter as Kai Loves You, K-A-I-L-O-V-E-S-U. I am also on Instagram. Just add a two to that, Kai Loves You too. We are out of here and very thankful and grateful for being able to share this version of story for the Survivance Project.
Don't forget to visit.
Yeah, visit survivance.io. Anyone that's interested in looking at the stories, reading the stories, or submitting your own story, survivance.io is where you can do that.
Thank you so much for having me. It's such a pleasure to talk to two of you. Such a wonderful time.